Well, this morning we have with us once again Roxy. And there's a bio for her on page 10 if you're wanting to know a little bit more about her. And she's going to come on up. Can we welcome her and give her a nice round of applause?
It's really good to be here, and I love the intimacy that this chapel provides, don't you think? I know that it could feel a little cramped, and as people arrive, just if you can, just shift over, maybe make some room so that people don't think, just kind of squeeze in there, if you wouldn't mind. So maybe you can even shift a little inwards, either aisles, a little, if you wouldn't mind. But it's so good to be here. It's great this summer, right? It's been a little hot, but I love Miami. I love the weather. I've been in D.C. for the past few months working on a client in Discovery. I work for a production company. I'm a consultant in finance and accounting. And so I've had the pleasure to kind of be in two cities. And it's been quite interesting, like the weather shock that I get every time I go back and forth. But it's been good. It's been a good summer. And I've been jumping in now in the middle of the song series, which I love. And this week in particular, I've been thinking of something interesting. It just came to mind, and so I thought that, you know, it's something relevant and something that God kind of place in my heart, I believe that it's to share with you. And I've been thinking about my memory this week. And how in school it was so easy to memorize these large volumes of material, right? Like you could spit out these useful facts with such ease. And now it's difficult for me to remember, you know, phone numbers and addresses, and you know, thankfully the only phone number we have to remember these days is our own. But I just realized that as a culture, how easy it is to forget. Our lives are so busy. We have so much going on. It's hard to remember things. And for example, I was thinking, for instance, life is made up of all these days and weeks and months of circumstances that happen, right? Ups and downs. For instance, maybe you got a raise this week, or you happen to find a new job. Or maybe you worked on a task this week, a spreadsheet, a document, a case, and your boss gave you a pat on the back or a thumbs up, and you felt good about yourself. You got a good grade in a class, and it felt good. Your daughter started walking for the first time this week, and it was awesome. You exercised, and you ate well, and you slept well. It was a good week. But at the same time, perhaps you lost a loved one this week. Or perhaps you found out that one of your family members, your children, has an illness. Or perhaps you did so much work, you stayed up so late on this task for work, and when you presented it, your boss came back telling you that there are all these errors and your tensions are up because you think, is this the straw that breaks the camel's back? And in all these good things and these bad things that happen, what I've realized is that I often focus on the things that I failed at during the week. I focus on the negative experiences I've had. And don't we all? How quickly we can forget the blessings. How quickly we can forget the good that happened in that same week, that same month, that same year. All the ways that God has provided for us that week. And how desperately I found that we need to remember. I have a feeling that in a room this size, many of you have experienced incredible provision from God. In a room this size, many of you have experienced provision in situations that seem literally quite impossible in the past. Provision in a time of relationship crisis, or physical crisis, or emotional crisis. Provision that could not have come from anywhere else but out of the loving and gracious hand of our God. And today, if you're honest, today is the first time in a long while that you've thought about that provision.
forgotten how good our God was to you when you needed it the most. Maybe you've forgotten how he came through for you when you were completely and utterly lost, when you felt like your world was falling right out from under you. Would I be correct in thinking that maybe some of you can relate to what I'm saying this morning? Some of you have forgotten to remember the provision that our Heavenly Father has given you during your life so far. And so that's exactly what I want to talk to you about this morning. Just that. I want to talk to you about how our God graciously provides for his people. We're in a series, almost coming to the end of the series, as you know, Summer in the Psalms. And honestly, I think this is a really important series. Because of my, potentially because of my history with the Psalms, for me personally, I came to start reading the Psalms because I needed something at night to quiet the anxiety that I felt. Just going to bed, I just needed something to quiet the anxiety. And so I happened upon the Psalms when I first became a Christian. And what I would do is I would just simply have them play on audio to me just while I was falling asleep. And sometimes at midnight or 1 a.m, I would wake up and I would still kind of hear Psalm 105 playing. You know, but what I found that it did is that it soothed me and it comforted me. It was like a warm blanket to my soul. Because the Psalms, they help us pray in any and every season of our lives. Because friends, the Psalms cover the whole spectrum of human emotion and experiences. And they show us that there is never a time that we cannot come. For instance, there are psalms that share about incredible joy. There are psalms that share about incredible sadness. There are psalms that express this real intimate love for God. And then there are also psalms that express when we feel distant or removed from God. There is never a time when we can't come to God with what we're feeling. And the psalm that we're looking at this morning is actually retelling the story of how God provided for people in the wilderness. And so I'm going to read this psalm for you this morning. Psalm 78, 23 to 29. Yet he gave a command to the skies above and opened the doors of the heavens. He rained down manna for the people to eat. He gave them the grain of heaven. Human beings ate the bread of angels. He sent them all the food they could eat. He let loose the east wind from the heavens and by his power made the south wind blow. He rained meat down on them like dust, birds like sand on the seashore. He made them come down inside their camp, all around their tents. They ate till they were gorged. He had given them what they craved. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. And so this psalm is telling us, it's retelling the story of how God provided for his people when they were in slavery in Egypt. So it's retelling, it's a remembering psalm. And now the actual account of this is from Exodus 16. And so what happened is God had promised them that he would give them their own land. He would give them this promised land. And so at first they had to live in the wilderness. And they were there for a minute, 40 years in fact. And it was during this time that God graciously provided for his people. Who? Right there. That's what we're going to be talking about this morning. This psalm is retelling and recounting. And if you still have your brochure open, the pamphlet open, you'll see on verse 22, it's talking about an all-powerful God, a sovereign God, God that commanded the skies above, doors of heaven, and rained down manna for all the people to eat. Look down at verse 27. It says that he rained down meat on them like dust, birds like sand on the seashore. This is what happened. Every single day that the Israelites were in the wilderness, God provided for them. He provided meat for them in the evening, and he provided bread and quail for them in the morning. Now, My husband is from Mississippi. And I know a guy right here sitting right here in the third row who's also from Mississippi, right? My husband's best friend. And he'll be able to vouch for me that people in Mississippi like to hunt, right? Yeah, so I've come to know a little bit about hunting for my husband. And so how it works with bird hunting, how it works, you can spend all day, right? You can spend all day hunting quail. And it's not guaranteed that you'll come home with any by the end of the day, right? And so what we're seeing here is that, I mean, you have guns and you have rifles, but what we're seeing here, you may come back with nothing. But what we see here is that God provides enough quail each evening for all the Israelites to eat to the full. That's a lot of birds. It's a lot of quail. And that's really a lot of days, right? Think about this. Just think about it for a minute. I want you to just picture yourself. We hear these stories over and over, but I want this to be real for you this morning, because this was such a, this is recorded in our history book over here. This is real. So I want you to imagine this. Go back with me. Go back and open the eyes of your heart right now and imagine with me what it was like. The quail would just fall from heaven and land all over where the people were captive. It would just land all over. And it says, the psalmist says, he let loose the east winds from the heavens, and by his power, he made the south wind blow. I mean, God is manipulating the elements. He's manipulating the winds and the skies in order to provide for his people. That would be a dream for my father in Mississippi, my father-in-law in Mississippi. Just him just chilling there by the campfire, and these quail just start dropping down from the sky, you know? And then in the morning, the people of Israel would wake up, and they would peer out of their tents. And what they would see this bread-like substance just lying all over the ground, right? And the psalmist calls it the grain of heaven, the bread of angels. Now, I don't know about you, but that makes me think of those sweet, that sweet Hawaiian bread, you know? Those sweet Hawaiian rolls, you know? To be honest, for me, that is bread, that's as angelic as bread in kind. And so, we don't know if that was pre-packaged or anything like that, but it was this sweet bread, the bread of angels, the grain from heaven. And this is what the people lived on for 40 years. 40 years they were living in the wilderness. And for 40 years God provided it. My friends, God is teaching his people. He was teaching his people how to depend on him. He was teaching his people how to trust him. Imagine what it was like for me, just for a second. They would get up each morning, right? And they would wonder, is this going to be the morning that God doesn't come through on his promise? Is this going to be the morning that God doesn't provide? And so they would get up and they would peer through their tents and they would say, oh, yes, it's there! Sweet Hawaiian rolls! He provided! Be like that. Imagine what it would do to one's faith. Imagine, well, there you go, we've got food to eat again. And I also believe that there's a lesson in there, buried in there also, about contentment. Contentment. That I believe that we Miamians would do well to learn. God commanded the Israelites to gather enough food for a day. So what we read, and some of you know the story, right? If they would gather too much for that day, they would kind of be a little greedy, they would gather too much and kind of hoard it. The next day, all that bread that was left over was rotten, maggots, just black, just rotten. And so the only day that they were able to collect a little more, right, was like on Saturday, because the Sabbath was coming and God was teaching them that he could trust him on the Sabbath to provide. And so the bread did not rot on the Sabbath, like if they collected extra. And so God was teaching them something about rest as well. It's interesting how God brings all these principles that are so relevant still for us today. Rest on the Sabbath. And how we can trust him on the Sabbath. We can rest because in the end it's not us who provides for us. It's a hard thing for me to have had to learn coming from South Africa and not having much at all, you know. literally just kind of going from day to day, trying to figure out what I was going to do after college, and realizing that at the end of the day, all those things that came my way weren't me providing for myself. It was God putting all those circumstances and things in place so that I could take the next step, and I could get that job, and then I could afford this, and then I could afford that, and then it was like, wow. And that's how it is for each and every one of you. It's not us who provides for us. It's our God who provides. And so this lesson about learning to be content, it just brought to mind Proverbs 30 for me. Those of you who know Proverbs 30, it says, Lord, don't give me so much that I'm tempted to think that I don't need you. And don't give me too little so that I'm tempted to steal. Instead, just give me my daily bread. The author of that proverb is referring to our ancestors in the wilderness. God was teaching his people how to trust him and how to be content without becoming greedy. My friends, I would suggest that he's teaching us that same thing every time we pray the prayer. Lord, give us today our daily bread. And every time we gather together and say the Lord's Prayer. And I think another thing that's worth noting for us today is that they call this bread manna. And in Hebrew it's called, what is it? And so these people who were getting this bread on the ground every day, they didn't even know what it was. They had never experienced anything like it before. It's like, did you gather your portion of what is it today? Could I break a piece of your what is it? You could basically say it's like watching a moment. They didn't know what it was. They had never seen it before when they were gathering it for 40 years. And I think that the lesson here is that sometimes God's blessing and grace, sometimes his great blessing and great grace comes in ways that we don't expect. Sometimes he'll provide for us in a way that he hasn't done in the past. Know that, friends. Sometimes he will provide for you. Your greatest blessings, your greatest provisions will come sometimes in a way that you could never, ever expect, that you could never, ever fail. Now that you've known a little bit about the background, right, of how, where this song has come from and where these seven voices are pointing to, I want to just talk for just a few minutes about the importance of, isn't she just so cute? I look at her, the importance of remembering. We read at the beginning of this, we didn't read at the beginning of the song, but what it said at the beginning of the song was the psalmist was retelling and recalling the stories of what God had done. I just love these stories because it's kind of like watching this movie. Of, you know, you think about how God came and the Israelites were there was this big sea in front of them, right? There was this sea and there was this army behind them. A lot of us have found ourselves in that position where we have this looming target or the circumstance ahead of us and these enemies and these things from our past that have just been overwhelming us, and yet we're waiting for God to come and intervene in the circumstance. And yeah, in this book, it's this visual image of what God can do in our life. And so at the last minute, because God is the God of drama after all, at the last minute you see the sea just part and these people walking through, and at the last minute the enemy has come over and the water just crashes down and the enemy is destroyed. And this is what our ancestors got to see, and I believe that this is what we can see in our daily life. I don't believe this is just then and this is now. I believe that is now as well. Because the same God that opened up the Red Sea can open up that circumstance for you if you trust him and you believe that it's not going to be in the same way that you've ever seen it before. Those sweet Hawaiian rolls. They didn't even know what it was. left me have long memories. There's this book that I like to read. I've read it recently called The Unhurried Life. I don't know if any of you have read that. It's really worth a read. By Alan Fagan. And here is what it says. I just love these words. I want to read it to you because I can't say it as well as what it said in this book. He said, "You and I benefit when we choose to recall past experiences of God's care when we're struggling, in order to see such expressions in the present." And then he goes on to write, I love this. "What am I to do to the pace of my heart if I were more confident of God's genuine desire to bless me? If I were more confident, what would it do to the pace of my heart if I were more confident for God's genuine desire to bless me? Would I rush around trying to achieve and grab? If I let myself believe that God longs to give me more than I can clutch in my white knuckle fist?" It's good, right? This past week, just meditating and just thinking about this passage that we read and God's provision, you know, Him taking off His shirt, flexing His muscles, and showing us His power, and not just a little bit, a lot. Just thinking about that, I thought about, you know, a circumstance. I just thought about one circumstance in my life. I don't know if He's ever done this, where I just sat down and I just thought about this one circumstance where God came through when I needed Him the most. I'll never forget that. I felt as though there was just no other way for me. And I wrote down that circumstance because I know that He intervened at the last minute, because God is the God of drama. And He intervened and He has put my life on a trajectory that I never could have expected. You see me standing up here today, polished woman. This is not who I was 10 years ago. And it's all because I trusted Him in that moment. And so writing that down, I just thought about how He does come through. He does care. And then another instance came to mind. And then another. And another. And then here's what I've come to believe. I've come to believe, and I wonder if some of you can relate, I've come to believe that we often default into thinking that we're on our own. We often default into thinking that we've got to provide for ourselves. We've got to make things happen. And most of our anxiety and worry stems from such thinking. That's where it comes from. And just the small act of remembering what God did for me. It did something to my heart, my friends. And I've carried it ever since. The power of remembrance. Being a people with long memories. Tony Campolo, he's a fiery Italian sociologist, preacher who I love. He tells a story from his childhood of a time when he was just starting elementary school. And it was just about the time when he was getting ready to be able to walk to school and back. But because of the area that they lived in, it was a little dangerous. And so the mom thought that she would get maybe an older girl, and she would ask the older girl if she would come to the house and walk with Tony to school so that he could get there safely and then walk back. And so the mom said, "If you do this, I'll give you a nickel." I know that doesn't sound like much, but back then it was a lot. So that elementary girl was ecstatic. She was like, "Yes, I'll do it." And so every morning she came and she got Tony and they walked together to school, and then she walked him safely back home, and that went on for about a year until Tony decided that it was time for him to walk to school by himself. He said that he suddenly became concerned about keeping the Campolo money. And so he went to his mom and he begged her and he pleaded on for her to let him walk to school alone. He was ready, he was old enough. And his mom was like, no, Tony, no, not a chance. And he begged his mom, "I can do it, please." And so finally, she gave in and she let him walk to school. And so there he was, walking by himself. He walked there the first day, and then he walked back, and he was good, you know, man of independence, stacking up those nickels. And he said it wasn't until decades that he heard the true story. It was actually at his mother's funeral. His sisters were quite a bit older than him. And so they were sitting around and they were just, you know, recalling fond memories of his mom and laughing. And so Tiny brought up the story from elementary school. And he just wanted to point out and remind them how independent he was, even from an early age. And so the sisters just began dying laughing, just dying. And so he was a little confused. You know, they said to him, "Sorry, do you really think that you went to school alone? Do you really think that you walked home alone? You walked to school then and then walked home alone every day that you left the house, Tony? Mom was following you every day. Didn't it occur to you, Tony, that when you would walk home and then and ring the doorbell, that a minute or two would pass by before you would be led in the house? Didn't that ever occur to you? Because what Mom did is that she waited for you at school and then she would follow behind you, and then when you would get close to home, she would sneak around the back and then she would let you in. It never occurred to you, Tony. She opened the front door and she would let you in, and it always left you with the impression that you had been on your own, when in reality she had been watching over you the whole time. And so it is with us. At times you and I are tempted to think, to believe we are on our own, when in reality the Heavenly Father is watching over us. He's caring for us. You don't live in a random universe, my friends. There is a God who cares for you, who watches over you, a God who provides for you. The psychotherapist, who I've read a little bit on, Scott Peck, he thinks that we are product or recipient of countless miracles. He says, if you look back on your life and you're ready to examine different experiences and situations that you've been through, you'll see that there's all sorts of instances. Things easily could have gone wrong, right? All sorts of interesting instances, if you look back, where things easily could have gone wrong, but they didn't. He says, if you really think about it, you'll come to the same conclusion. He cites numerous examples from his childhood, dating early back to times where he could have been seriously injured or even died. He says that the number of accidents that have almost happened far outweigh the accidents that actually do happen. This is psychotherapist talking. Not a Christian, he's a psychotherapist, and he says, it's almost as if someone is watching over. He says that it would appear that there is a grace at work in our lives. Isn't that interesting? My friends, you do not live in a random universe. There is a God who cares for you and who watches over you. And so today I just urge you to take some time to reflect on the ways He is gracious. Just a moment this week. Maybe no need to even write it down. Just take a moment in your car, you know, before a meeting, before you go to a meal. You know, you have those 5 minutes, those little gaps that I've spoken to you about before. Take some time to think about that situation or event where He really provided for you, and allow that to carry you through, to energize you, to expect that to happen again in the present. It's been said that the book of Deuteronomy can be summed up in one word. What do you think that is? Remember. And that's because the word is used hundreds of times in that book. There's a power in remembering. There really is. Because remembering how God has provided us in the past helps us to trust Him with the present and the future. I'll end with this. There's this marriage counselor, John Gottman, and he wrote this book, fascinating book. And what he says, he's been studying marriages and the dynamics of marriages for quite a long time, for years and years. And so he's become very good at just being able to just spot these different indicators of how people react with one another, how they gel with one another. And so what's been interesting about him, and this is something that he's very well known for, a study after study he's done, and you know, he's noted this, and it's happened over and over again. He's been noted for being able to meet a couple. And within the first 15 minutes of meeting them and kind of seeing these different indicators that are going on, he's able to tell whether the marriage will be a happy one or whether it will end in divorce. Fascinating thing. I mean, he's not a prophet. He's not, you know, a magician. He just has come to study these indicators of what leads to a flourishing relationship and then what leads to the other reality. And so one thing that I find interesting is one of the small indications that he has found, one of them is how well the couple remembers the past. Isn't that interesting? That's one of the indicators. He says, he asked the couple, what's your earliest memories of one another? Tell me about that. He asked them, what was your first date like? What was your first year of marriage like? Describe how you first met. And then he said, when it's hard for the couple to remember, or maybe when the couple isn't interested in really remembering, he says that's a pretty good indicator that the marriage may not make it. And you know, my friends, that's true with our relationship with God. There is a power in remembrance. We need to be able to remember the ways that God has provided for us. And we need to carry those memories with us. We need to allow those memories to strengthen us in the present and to grow our relationship. Isn't it interesting that on the last night that Jesus was together with his disciples, he said, do this in remembrance of me. I pray, my friends, that we become a people with long never forget to remember. Pray with me. Lord Jesus, thank you so much for this church. Thank you that it's not just a building. Thank you that it's full of hearts and souls and minds that are seeking after you. And so Lord, I just proclaim right now in the name of Jesus, Lord, I proclaim that you stir something special in every single person under the sound of my voice today, this morning. You stir something, you stir it, a word for each person here, that they would know that they've heard a direct and personal word from you. Because we know that you're not a distant God. You're a God that comes down and strips yourself of your royalty. And you've become one of us and you've died for us. And so Lord, we know and we want to believe that you love us so much. And so help us doubt our doubts. I pray that all in Jesus' name.